Welcome back to Feels Like Weezer, where we're going through all of Weezer's catalog, track by track, song by song. I'm Eric Nash from Watchmen Minute.
And I'm Zach Franking Smith. You can follow me on Twitter, at The Informal Log. And we have a special guest today, Eric.
That's right.
To my right is...
Matt Thomas, the Rambo Minion from Studio Red Band. Thank you, and thank you for having me. This is great.
That was like the raddest intro I've ever heard. I am a huge Rambo fan. I know we need to get talking about Weezer here, but I need to know, what is your favorite Rambo kill?
Oh, my favorite kill?
Yeah.
Damn. There's so many great ones. Like the mud exactly. Kill is good. The exploding arrow one is good. The Harold Diamond spin kick when Kurov goes down the tunnel and it explodes. I think my favorite one is in Rambo 4, right after he cuts the guy's head off and he points the 50 caliber into the truck and just turns that guy inside out. I think that's my favorite.
Man. My favorite is in Rambo 3, the one you were talking about, where, like, he doesn't just kill him, he, like, overkills him.
Yeah.
Like, he ties the noose around his neck, he shoots him, he roundhouse kicks him into a hole, and pulls a pin on a grenade so he explodes. Like,
yeah,
it's so, like, over-the-top 90s that I love it. It's so great.
It's cool because there's a lot of ways that went down. I know, like, the guy who actually does the kick is Harold Diamond. It's not Sly. It's the guy from the stick fighting scene in the beginning. Mm. It's him made up to look like Rambo. And he came on and talked about it at length. It was amazing. All the stuff that they were also going to do, that was cool. But I know in the script, Kurov gets killed off by Musa, which is the guy who goes on the journey with Rambo, who leads him in. He actually does a kind of like a suicide thing where he pulls a grenade and he jumps on Kurov and then they both explode. And I think in the other original take for it, Rambo's on a horse and he goes and he sees like the Zeiss, the main bad guy, on a carrier, like going under a cliff, and he jumps off the cliff with the horse and he spins his knife around and he staples the guy's head to the chair, I guess, and like the driver's seat, and he crashes the horse into the mountain and almost dies. Yeah. And then Kurov comes up to him, and Rambo's like mortally wounded, and he thinks that Kurov's gonna kill him and he can't fight back, and he's just like, thank you, because you know you had to save me from doing that myself, kind of thing. Yeah. Pretty cool.
I think the only thing that could have made that better was when Rambo crashed the horse, like it exploded, you know.
I'm like, sure it did. Yeah, they don't mention what happened to the horse, but there's a lot of horses that die around Rambo in that script. With like, there's a sandstorm scene where the horse gets buried and he has to dig out the horse and stuff.
Does he cut it open? Yeah, stay in it like a tauntaun?
No.
Oh, boy.
One of the versions of Rambo 5 was based on a book where they had a scene where this creature fights this bear, kills the bear, leaves it there, and Rambo performs an autopsy on the bear with the knife, which was pretty cool. Pretty cool.
It looks like this bear died of internal hemorrhaging.
Yeah.
Well, welcome to the show, Matt.
Thank you.
5 minutes in, we're already like super off track. That's the best way to start it. Eric,
thank you.
We're talking about a song today. What are we talking about?
We're talking about Photograph.
Not the Nickelback one, right?
Oh, I hope not.
If you want it, you can have it. But you gotta learn to reach out there and grab it. Cause everybody wants some love. Shoot it from the stars above. And though my heart will break, there's more than I could take. I could never get enough. If you need it, you should show it. Cause in my place, so monastic that you blow it. Cause everybody wants some love.
What'd you think of this song, man?
I love this song. Ever since I first heard it, my friend Pat Barry had this record, and we would all listen to it while we were wasting time and hanging out and having a good time back in the day. And I remember when I heard this, I was just floored by this song. A lot of the songs on this I really liked, like Don't Let Go, I really liked. And mm-hmm. I remember I was at my friend Julie Innes' house when I first saw the Hash Pipe video. And I was like, yeah. I was like, there's new Weezer? This is awesome. Awesome. I guess I discovered Weezer at a time of my life going into high school where there was really big changes that happened for me, like super, super big changes. And I remember everybody loved that Blue album. It was everywhere you went. And it helped me through a lot of that. And then, you know, later on when Pinkerton came out, I thought that was a really cool, you know, sophomore effort for it. I thought that was really, you know, I don't know. It's such a drinking album, but at the same time, it reminds you a lot. I don't know why Weezer reminds me a lot of Kevin Smith, but maybe from the Suzanne era, but I don't know. Just good times. Really good times.
Oh, yeah. I think that's what's really important about Weezer, and I think that's what this song, I think, is about, you know, where it's, you know, the guy's, if you look at the lyrics, the guy's heartbroken. To me, it seems like he just recently got broken up with, but it's like, remember all of the good times, you're going to get back up, you know, look at the photograph of love, you know, it's going to be all right. And I think that that's what is so quintessentially Weezer about Weezer, in my opinion, is that they are just a, you know, they're a party guy. They're just, you know, like, hey guys, we're gonna hang out. We're just bros. We're broing.
Yeah, I love, you know, how it took like old school geek rock and brought it to like this new platform.
Yeah,
you know, and it really, I find like to that generation, I find it was really cool because it really showcased, you know, I guess like how some of the simplest things are the best form or way of doing things, and having brought back such a sound, I think, that was forgotten at the time was really important. I think we really needed that, especially, you know, at that time where everything was either alternative or grunge or, you know, so.
What'd you think of this, Eric?
I really do like this song pretty well. I think it's poppy, but it goes into that, it gets that harder moments at points, you know. I think what Rivers is saying sometimes at certain points, I think within a song, even it can have some pretty good meaningfulness and depth to it, but at other points, you know, it's just that simple power pop, though.
Yeah.
Stuff, well, about love and girls, what have you.
And it definitely does go, and I kind of talked about these in the last couple episodes, but, you know, it's a return to form, but it's still, I feel like, a little too much like, you know, Blue Album Weezer. And, you know, I feel like they didn't adventure out further enough than they should have. I mean, this song's okay. I mean, I don't hate it, but, you know, individually, I like it. But,
yeah, I find it's the Green Album's weird because it's a great album and it's a good comeback album, but it doesn't kind of fit like what you would think of a Weezer trilogy. Mm-hmm. You know, it feels to me like a jumping off point for Green. It doesn't feel like a conclusion. I don't know, but like you see, like right after Green, then all these other albums start dropping, like boom, 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 boom. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's a lot of good stuff on that. Yeah. Sorry.
It's almost like it's almost going on with what you're saying, trilogy. I mean, it's almost like there was supposed to be a third album in between Pinkerton and Green.
Yes.
That didn't get made.
Should have been. This
was the logical next one. You know, if that had happened, it would have made more sense for this to have been there and doing what it's doing. If a third one kind of had happened.
What it should have been, it should have been Blue, Maladroit, Pinkerton. That should have been the order, and I will defend this with my dying breath, you know.
So you're doing your own machete order.
It's
of
Weezer's albums. Look, it is the only way to listen to Weezer albums, you know.
Well, I heard you guys talking about those 121 songs he wrote around that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they could have, you know.
Oh, they could have
done something there. I wonder how many of those songs were Maladroit songs, you know?
There were quite a few, yeah, because I was looking at, you know, and I think that's why they were able to release, because it was like, 02 they released Maladroit, 03, 04 they released Make Believe, and then Red was 05, 06, somewhere in there. And so it's like, boom, 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 you're right, they just came out so quickly. But I think there... The reason why this album is the way that it is because they're trying to appease the record company. That is my thought on that.
Yeah.
And we see that also with Island in the Sun, it just the music videos with that, which we'll talk about next week, but
that's you a know, good one too.
It's such a good tune. It's the best song on the album, I will say. But unless we count the Christmas song, then that one's the best. But because that has two music videos,
yeah,
and you know, just because MTV didn't like the first one, they made a new one with Spike Jonze, which is probably like one of the best music videos I've ever seen. Made me so happy when I watched it. But we'll talk about that next week. But I still think that this is a reaction. This is way too reactionary, you know, when it should have been like, you know, when you're writing about how, you know, you're quirky and you're different, you know, then you should be quirky and different. You shouldn't be just... Anyway, that is my opinion, my very important opinion that everybody needed to hear about the Green Album.
Well, digging into the lyrics a bit here, because I do have a couple things I want to point out. In the second verse, monastic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as in relating to monks, nuns, or others living under religious vows.
Wow, did you come up with that on your own?
Or the buildings in which they live.
Hmm.
It can be also a word just to describe a building, but...
Right.
I don't think that's what he's going for here, but...
Well, yeah, because it's... What he's going for with that is, you know, you should get out there, you know, be yourself. Don't be so... like uptight, like how a monk or a nun would be, which that's a great line. I had no clue what the hell he was saying.
Or maybe kind of closed off.
Yes.
Would you say is that a better?
Yeah, because I think
that's why I envision, you know, being in a order of monks in a building in a convent or nuns convent. I can't remember what the temple or what have you, and just being shut off from the world.
Right?
Kind of, yeah.
Monks are in an abbey.
Abbey? Abbey normal?
Well, I know that, like, the guys just, like, party up to the song a lot. And I remember we were watching that Clerks cartoon when they released the anime for that. Mm-hmm. And they had that great, can the virus kill the grimace moment. Mm-hmm. I remember, like, my friend Tom would just sing that to this song. He'd be like, you know, can the virus kill the grimace? No, nothing in the world can kill the grimace as long as we all stay in the dome, oh baby. And I'm like, yeah, man, that works. So this song is always like, I don't know, just stuck in my head when I think of good times and good friends and stuff.
Oh, good.
Yeah. Contrary to the good times, monks live in monasteries.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
I mean, it's not like it's in the root word or anything like that that we were talking about. they're also called abbeys, by the way. But yeah, I think that because all of Weezer songs are about love, honestly, in one way or another. And this, you know, it's about being, you know, getting out there, you know, doing it. You gotta shoot your shot, man.
Yeah.
Is this like kind of like the counterpoint to In the Garage?
Hmm.
That's because, a great
because in the garage, I even heard it recently. Someone else on a podcast probably mentioning in the garage and comparing it to the Beach Boys in my room,
Which was a big inspiration for the song. I think honestly, but yeah, that's I guess I can kind of see it as that where, but I, you know, they're kind of like you're within the garage. That's so singular. That's about, it's personal. It's about him, you know, it's him in a relationship with himself, essentially. Like, it's okay to be this, you know, D20 rolling nerd. So I guess this could be part two where it's like, look, man, just get out there. This is, don't be so closed off. Don't be so in on yourself.
Yeah, he's not saying I shouldn't be so closed off. He's saying you.
Right. So it's somebody talking to him. It's somebody talking to the kid who's in the garage. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like this. I like this theory. Where are we going to go from here?
His past self.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, my God. Well, then it's really... Oh, I like this theory a lot.
Have you guys seen Weezer on tour?
No.
No?
Nor I.
I saw them for Green. I saw them for Green. Yeah. I guess it was going in more near Malagoa, but I saw them with Ozma and Saves a Day. I remember being really charmed by both of those bands. I went out to lobby, but I only had enough money left over to get one CD, so I got the Ozma CD, and I saw one of the guys from, I think, Evan from Saves a Day. So I went up to him and I asked him to sign my CD, even though, you know, it was the Ozma CD. And he wrote like, you know, thank you on the CD cover, and he wrote, Evan is not in this band. Which
it's for a very specific collector.
Yeah.
They'll pay a lot of money for it.
Yeah. And my niece got to see them at Montebello Rock Fest this year. This year or last year? I can't remember. But she said she really enjoyed it. And they played some Smashing Pumpkin songs, which I thought was really, really cool. Because I'm a big Pumpkin
fan. Nice.
I have another lyric thing. So my second lyric thing I was going to say earlier. So and it's actually another Blue Album call out to me. It's calling back, reminding me of My Name is Jonas.
Mm-hmm.
It's the outro. All of a sudden in the outro, he goes into this thing that doesn't really seem to, you know, have any kind of connection, it seems to me, with the rest of the song. But it's the just sit, drawing up the plans and re-erect it. So this kind of more, you know, architecture, building, engineering kind of thing that's similar to My Name is Jonas with his brother. And
Well, and I think that is representative of, you know, he's supposed to be asking somebody out. That's how I view this song. Or getting back out from after a breakup, and which is the whole album of Pinkerton. So even if you blow it, don't reject the idea. Just draw it up again and try it. You know, I think that's kind of what he's saying there.
That's how success is done, right? You gotta fail 100 times to succeed once, and that's the name of the game.
Exactly. I mean, I've failed lots of times.
Oh, failure is my middle name.
That's about it as I've got lyrically well. Right. So you guys got anything else?
Well, the thing I have to say at the very beginning, what we hear right off the bat are these kind of some odd sounds, some spacey, almost spacey kind of sounds to me. Certainly some of them created with guitar, and I feel like, you know, there's just little hints of that they reincorporate in throughout the song. Like like right after that chorus the first time. Oh no, I'm sorry, no, not the first time. Prior to verse 3, so after the second time, essentially, I guess, you have the chorus. Prior to verse 3, you hear a little bit of it, and also again from the chorus to the outro, and that little, you get these whirring sounds. How was that?
What did you guys think of the music video?
I like it. I always like those kind of, like, you know, behind-the-scenes footage music videos. This was directed by Carl Koch, unofficial fifth member of Weezer.
Yeah.
Which I thought was kind of cool. You know, their good buddy came in and directed the video for him. But, no, I think that the music video is fun. Scott Schreiner's in it. Not Mikey Walsh. He had quit by this time, so I guess that's all I've got for the song, for the music video.
It's a pretty good one. It's simple, too. I like that it's simple. It almost feels like it was, you know, just a band just doing it by themselves. I like a lot of that stuff about video capture devices. You know, like when they do the little Christmas thing and Pat, I think it's Pat Wilson's like, I'm going to eat you now or something like that. Where he's like, where he's all evil when he jumps out. If you guys do that, I want to be on that episode. That's my favorite moment from that. But, and I really like the early, like the, when they would switch up like certain songs, like when they play them live, I really like that aspect of it.
Well, yeah, that's another huge thing for this one. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. This is what they would do that with.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went and grabbed and saw watched one instance of it happening at least, and it actually involved continuation from the song into, you know, and just part of this song and then part of song two by Blur.
Yeah, with Pat Wilson singing.
Sing and play guitar, and Rivers back on drums.
That's awesome.
Just a straight switch between the two of them.
Yeah, I always think that's kind of cool when they do that because it just shows the versatility of a lot of the members of the band, you know. I have one more thing I want to say about this song. And it was originally called If You Want It.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is a much better title than Photograph. Here's the thing. They have a song called Crab on here. Like,
yeah.
They should do something better for some of the other ones, because Crab is just, it's top of the line. That's a great title.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I love overall, that. Oh, go ahead.
I love the hi-hat on Crab. That. I love that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, no, that's fine. So, yeah, that's all I've got for this one.
The other thing I'd point out musically, though, is just like 10 in the range of 10 to 20 seconds into the song,
mm-hmm.
There's the distorted guitar that's only in the left channel.
Oh,
They love that left channel.
Yeah,
it's like Van Halen.
Well,
like the early Van Halen, how they would channel all their instruments. Like each like apart from maybe like Eruption and a couple others, but each one has like a different channel, drum, bass, guitar. Pretty cool.
Which, as somebody who has a really crappy car, I don't appreciate this channeling. My stereo was not good, thank you very much. But it's, I don't know, it's just, that's cool, I guess. I don't know what it means, but
you got to do a mono mix. You got to throw that on Audacity and then just make it like the center channel and the left and the right channel. So no matter what channel you get all the instruments together.
That sounds like so much work that I do not want to do. I don't think it's worth it, man. At that point, I don't think it's worth it. Like, I'll just put it on my phone and drop it in a cup holder or something.
Yeah.
So I think, are we ready to do our ratings?
Well, I think we have covers to talk about.
Oh, we have covers! God damn it! Yeah. What?
There's one cover that I found by The Vibrators.
Oh, ooh. Boy! I hear they're
vibrant.
All the buzz.
All the buzz.
quite stimulating.
Thank you for listening to Feels Like Weezer. This is our last episode.
We're in dad joke area.
Oh boy.
Yeah. So
what kind of group were they? Like, I'm just wondering.
I didn't look further into it. I mean, it's definitely it was on the punk tribute to Weezer. So they're definitely on the punker side of things.
So probably a punk band.
They're not chiptune.
Right, not chiptune. Punk band. Okay, so now are we ready to do our ratings?
Sure.
Okay.
Zach, what would you rate this song? Photograph.
I like it better than Don't Let Go, so I'm going to give it like a 6.5.
I'm trying to think, like, am I rating this on just the one song itself or against all the other Weezer songs?
Against every song.
Ooh. I don't know. I think I give it maybe the same, like a 6.5 or 7. But definitely on the Green Album, it's my favorite song.
Hmm.
Yeah.
You can go 6.75.
Yeah, we could do that.
We had a pie before, so. Or double or two pie. Pie, actually. Double pie. Yeah, it was a double pie.
Yeah.
It wasn't that low.
It was photogenic of the times, so I'll say that.
Good time. Thanks for coming on the show, man.
Thank you.
Eric, what's your rating for this one?
I'm going to give it right in a row here. I'll give it a 7.
Oh, look at us. The average on that is 6.75.
Mm-hmm.
I did that math in my head.
Sounds good.
Wait. Myself.
We didn't copy the calculation in the spreadsheet. Oh, man.
Oh, this is terrible. Scrap it. We're done.
Now we know what we gave the last song because we didn't have that one either. Well, we did that episode.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show, Matt.
Thank you guys. This is awesome. I'm sorry it took so long.
Oh, yeah. The behind the scenes stuff with trying to get Matt on the show has been nuts.
Well, yeah, because I've been trying to also do the Tron minute, right? And I just, like, it's like one thing after another. But things are starting to move smoothly now. So I'm hoping we get back to normal.
Where can we find you on the internet?
Rampomania on Studio Red Band is on YouTube under Studio Red Band.
Yeah.
And then on archive.org we have the new Studio Red Band, or Studio Red Band 2, I guess. And Facebook, we have Rambo Mania Forever. But the one, if you go on Rambo Mania Forever on Facebook, you can find all new stuff. And we got some pretty good guests this week.
The real question, is it 4, like the number? Or is it F-O-R?
It's F-O-R. But I was going to do like the sideways 8, like the infinity. And then ever, but I don't know. We got a lot of different projects. Yeah, we got a lot of different projects that we're working on, not just Rambo. So,
Well, great. That's and so you're on the Movies by Minute page as well, right? The website, moviesbyminutes.com.
Yeah, so for Movies by Minutes, it looks like I'm going to do 7 episodes of Rambo Minute, but those 7 are going to be, like, long. Like, you know,
right.
like a week's worth each one. And then I think we're going to do Force of Freedom. And then I think I'm going to try my hat at Cobra, because I already interviewed people for Cobra to do the Movies by Minute. And some actresses and actors and stuff. So,
oh, nice.
I think that's coming sooner or later, maybe around May for the anniversary. Needed
more people in the Movies by Minutes community to do those like awesome action movies, like the buff dude action movies of the 80s. Like, that's what we need.
Yeah. Of,
so
when I get through that, I would like to actually do one that's like actual minute by minute, like how everybody else seems to be doing them. I really admire that, because it's such a labor of love. Even with what you guys are doing is great too, because you're going track by track, you're going all out, you know. And it's I know a lot of people think it's easy to do, but that we just press a button and it magically happens. But there's so much that goes into what you do.
Oh,
so
for sure.
I really
way more than I thought you. Was.
Yeah.
Oh. He's regretting.
I'm locked in for another 2 years. So, Eric, where can we find you online?
Yeah, like I said at the beginning, I'm currently working on Watchmen Minute Redux, in a way, you know, because of the HBO show. We're putting out episode by episode each week, you know, just within a couple days of it coming out on Sunday night. We're usually up Tuesday morning with the new episode, recapping. And then there's my other, my current, truly ongoing movie by minute show, Almost Famous Minute. And you can find me at Lucky Mustard on Twitter and at Lucky Mustardine on Instagram. Google all over for
just Google shows.
I gotta say, Watchmen's not an easy one to do either.
Well, and we did the director's cut, so that was 186 minutes.
Good episode. God.
Damn. 186 yeah.
186 minutes.
Too That's long. What I'm talking about.
But then for Almost Famous, I chose not to do the theatrical, or not to do the extended cut.
You just did the theatrical.
Yeah.
I saw
just over two hours.
I saw someone posted a thing about the Watchmen intro. But I think it's like that the Night Owl saving Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I never noticed that. Ever.
Yeah, oh yeah. We delved in deep into a lot of the stuff that's going on in that, you know, 5 to 10 seconds.
Yeah.
It was within the 1 minute, and those episodes of covering the intro were some of our longer ones. I mean, we had some longer ones later on too, but
I think it was really cool too how like they have like the whole Batman, like the alternate version of the Batman Smashing Pumpkin theme in there.
Yeah,
for the trailer.
That, yeah, well, yeah, for the trailer. Yeah.
Yeah.
That
I remember seeing that trailer, and my face just hit the floor. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh my god, that's incredible.
Yeah, well, yeah, buddy of mine and I, we dressed up for the midnight premiere. Oh, we were nice. Both in high school. I was Rorschach. He was Dr. Manhattan. But funeral Dr. Manhattan. Yeah. So, just want to clarify. He did
there's
not walk
into the points where he's wearing, like, the unitard, and then there's just the more, like, the almost bikini brief.
Dude, the movie came out in March. We're going to go with the full suit, okay? Yeah. So, and you can find me on Twitter at The Informal Log. If you'd like to play video games with me, I am on PlayStation Network, The Informal Log as well. So come play video games with me. I'm bad at them, and I have no time. So just kidding. You can add me. And you can also find Feels Like Weezer on Facebook, on Twitter, at Feels Like Weezer. You can email us, feelslikeweezer@gmail.com. And you can check out this and lots of other great rock and roll podcasts on pantheonpodcasts.com. We just recently had an episode of Make It Stop. They dropped their Ratitude version, or their Ratitude cover. So you can listen to them.
What they do is they go through, they take one band and find what they consider to be the worst album of any one band.
Mm-hmm.
And they usually have a guest on that knows something about it. So
nice.
Yeah, they had someone good, I think, talking about that, you know, giving their take.
Yeah.
On Ratitude.
It was not us.
Can I throw in something really brief?
For sure.
If people out there are in the Montreal area, if they want to come see us, we're going to be doing a live show Wednesday the 13th of November with Young Rambo Mickey Moon Cardoni. Yeah, he's awesome, awesome. Well, we're going to be doing a live show down at Barfly on St. Laurent. So if anyone comes, I'm not sure what the tickets are at the gate, but they're usually pretty cheap, like a couple of bucks. But yeah, come hang out on the show with us. We're going to probably broadcast all night. So.
That'll have been last week, though.
Oh, it's next week?
This will be 2 weeks.
Or a couple weeks out.
Yeah.
After.
So.
Okay. Well, if you attended the show,
thank you for coming.
Thank you for coming out. Go back.
They've grown. They're now Nickel Return. They're, yeah. No, damn it. Dimebag. That would have worked better.